You're listening to The Hour of the Time. I'm Pooh.
And I'm William Cooper.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I'll be in to tuck you in later.
All right.
Good night, baby.
Good night.
Ladies and gentlemen, as most of you know, there may be some of you out there who do not, The Hour of the Time is leaving WWCR, and our last broadcast date on WWCR will be the last weeknight of the month of August. We will begin broadcasting on our new network on Monday, August the 19th. We will be simulcasting. We will be broadcasting on WWCR and our new network, and we will remain on this satellite. And I will let you know later in the week exactly what shortwave frequency. Will also be on another satellite, I understand, and over a period of time will be picked up by some AM stations across the country. And, of course, that's up to the AM stations whether they pick up this broadcast or not. You all have an opportunity. And based upon some of the other programming that they're carrying, I have no reason to believe that they will not. So, that is encouraging, ladies and gentlemen. And I think we'll be a lot better off. In the meantime, I want to thank everyone at WWCR who has helped make this broadcast possible over the last 4 years, and in particular Adam Locke, who has been sort of the guy who takes all the complaints and helps everybody and tries to make things work and make things better and interfaces. And if it weren't for Adam Locke, I got to tell you, WWCR probably wouldn't have any broadcasters, because if everybody had to talk to George McClintock, they just would go somewhere else, because that guy, you know, you pay him good money. You're paying that station good money, and then you have to put up with somebody like George McClintock. It's just, it's uncalled for. Nobody should ever have to do that. It's like going in and paying $1,000 for a stereo set, and the salesman slaps you in the face. That's how George McClintock is all the time. That's how he's always been. I can't tell you how many times I've had to hang up on George McClintock in the middle of a conversation. I wish I could count the times. And I can't tell you how many times Adam Locke has gone out of his way and risked the wrath of George McClintock and the station management to help me and many other people who broadcast on WWCR. And I can't tell you, you have to interface with the man over a long period of time to understand what a decent gentleman and a wonderful person Adam Locke really is. And, of course, there are a lot of other people at WWCR nobody ever hears about, nobody ever talks to, but if it weren't for them, there just wouldn't be any broadcast. So to all of you at WWCR who have helped make this broadcast a success over the last 4 years, I want to thank you sincerely from the bottom of my heart. I am sorry that I have to leave WWCR, but really your station manager has given me no choice. Nobody who has any decency or any honor could remain with a station after they have been lied to for 4 years and treated in the manner that this broadcast and this host has been treated by the station manager, not by the rest of you. There are three frequencies on WWCR, which go 24 hours a day, ladies and gentlemen. And those frequencies, I have been promised for 4 years, an earlier time slot, wherever one came up, that I would be the first one that they would call. They've never called me once for an earlier time slot, ladies and gentlemen. Not once, ever. And I know, and so have you known, that time slots have come up on the various three frequencies over and over and over again over the last 4 years. I was never called, never notified, never given an opportunity to take an earlier time slot, and was promised that when Tom Valentine retired or left the air, if he ever did, that I would be the first one that they would call to fill that two-hour time slot 5 nights a week. And not only was I not the first one that they called, but when I called to ask if I could have that time slot, I was told by George McClintock that this broadcast is too controversial to air at an earlier time slot. Well, George, which time slot are you talking about? Because right now they're listening to me on the West Coast at 9 p.m. East Coast, it's midnight. So which time slot are you talking about? You know, if I were to go into that old time slot on the East Coast, it would be 10 p.m. Are you trying to tell me that the 9 p.m. audience on the West Coast is a different kind of audience than it is at 10 p.m. on the East Coast? I don't think so, George. I think you're full of hot air, and I think you're full of bullshit. And because of that, you've not only lost Tom Valentine, you've lost the hour of the time, and you've lost a great source of revenue for your broadcast. Not only that, but whoever fills these time slots is going to be competing with me, and I have the largest shortwave listening audience in the world, bar none. And I got to tell you, while I wish them well, I don't know who they are. I know that they're going to suffer because of that. And you're the one, George McClintock, who has caused it. Don't go away, folks. I'll be right back after this short pause.
He has moved the faithful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. I have seen him in the watchfires of 100 circling camps. They have built him an altar in the evening news and dance. I have read his righteous sentence by the dim and flaring lamps. His day is marching on. Glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, another of my predictions just came true at the Republican National Committee, convention, I should say. Another one of my predictions just came through at the Republican National Convention. Remember I told you at the beginning when Pat Buchanan began running for president, I told you that his whole purpose was to take the attention of the disenchanted from the Republican Party and give them the illusion that they had a leader. I told you that he didn't have a chance in hell of being nominated. And I told you that when it was all over, he would stand up before his followers and tell them to unify behind the Republican Party and vote for Bob Dole. And that's exactly what he did. That is exactly what he did. He could have taken those people and created another third party. He could have taken those people and he could have garnered control of the Republican Party. Pat Buchanan badmouthed the militias, and he badmouthed a lot of good American patriots, whom he called radicals. Just who was he representing? Well, folks, I'll tell you. He was representing exactly who I told you who he was representing, the New World Order. Pat Buchanan is a Knight of Malta. He wrapped up his racist, never-say-die presidential campaign by calling an uneasy truce with the Republican Party. It was all an act, at least through Election Day, but some of his supporters are still resisting. On the eve of the Republican National Convention, Buchanan seemed on the verge of endorsing Bob Dole. He stopped short of uttering those words during an emotional speech Sunday to the volunteers and supporters he calls the Buchanan Brigade. What a joke that is. In fact, he mentioned Dole only in passing and didn't refer to running mate Jack Kemp at all, even though he has said Dole's choice for the number two spot would be a key factor in his endorsement decision. Instead, this is what he said, what amounts to the same thing as saying vote for Bob Dole. He said it is time for a party truce, and he urged his followers to join together in common cause to defeat Bill Clinton exactly as I told you he would do when he first announced that he was going to run for the presidential candidacy. The crowd at the Republican National Convention hooted down Oliver North, one of the warm-up speakers, when he said it would be counterproductive for Buchanan supporters to start a new third party. You see, Buchanan has ignored his own supporters. Buchanan's speech was interrupted 9 times by the adulatory crowd, which rose to its feet to clap and shout, "Go, Pat, go!" And all throughout the time, you could hear people yelling, "Third party! Third party! Third party!" Buchanan, who was a lifelong Republican who supported Barry Goldwater's campaign and was an aide to Presidents Nixon and Reagan, told the crowd, "America does not need a third party. What we need is a fighting second party that not only preaches but practices a conservatism of the heart. What unadulterated puke bullshit." Heralding the support garnered by his new conservatism, Buchanan hinted he might make another run for the presidency in the year 2000. What a joke. "The old era is over," he said. "The old order is passing away," he said. "It may bristle and it may resist, but within this party, a new party is being born." And with those words, he spoke the truth. The old era is over. The old order is passing away. The new world order is emerging. He ended his speech, ladies and gentlemen, by saying this, and I quote, Buchanan said this, quote, "I hope that the stone that the builders rejected becomes the cornerstone of the Republican Party." And all of those who have studied the mystery religion of Babylon and the Masonic order know exactly what that means. The cornerstone is the capstone that is now missing from the pyramid, ladies and gentlemen. And when you see it put into place, America will be dead and gone And if it's even allowed to be in the history books, will just be mentioned, not even, ladies and gentlemen, in the manner that we refer to the old Roman Empire. Will be brushed over as if it never existed at all. And what amazed me is all those ignorant fools, the stupid sheeple who sat in that audience and rose to their feet and applauded when he said the words, "I hope that the stone that the builders rejected will become the cornerstone of the Republican Party." And they didn't even know what he said. But they all rose to their feet and cheered and clapped and yelled because, oh, it sounded good, even though those stupid, ignorant sheeple fools had no idea what it was he was talking about. Nothing at all. Bob Dole is a 33rd degree Freemason of the southern jurisdiction of the Scottish Rite. And guess what? His running mate, Jack Kemp, Representative Jack F. Kemp, Republican, has been elected to receive the Scottish Rite 33rd degree and become honorary member of the Supreme Council of the Northern Masonic Jurisdiction. Kemp is a member of Fraternal Lodge F and A.M. in Hamburg, is a member of Palmoni Lodge of Perfection, the 14th degree, Palmoni Council, Princes of Jerusalem, 16th degree, Buffalo Chapter of Rose Cross. That's right, the Buffalo Chapter of the Rose Cross, 18th degree. And he is a member of the Knights Templar of the Buffalo Consistory, 32nd degree. The 33rd degree is to be conferred upon Representative Jack Kemp at the next annual session of the Supreme Council in September 1987 in Boston. How do you like those apples, ladies and gentlemen? And you think that you have a choice in who you vote for? You think your vote is going to end the New World Order? I got to tell you, Bob Dole is elected president, he will be worse than you ever dreamed that Bill Clinton could be. Bob Dole is no conservative. He's no Republican. He's a counterfeit, just like old Newt Gingrich. Bob Dole, throughout his career, has pretended to be a Republican, but every single time he has welched on his promise to the people and has voted for liberal bills, liberal laws. He voted for NAT and GAFTA after promising the American people that he would defeat those. He promised the American people he would repeal the assault weapons ban. Not only has he not done it, he's not going to do it. If he becomes president, he will not do it. Instead, he will pass and he will implement even tighter arms control, gun bans, and weapons registration laws, because that's what the New World Order demands. The article I read to you about Jack Kemp is from the Buffalo News. That's right, the Buffalo News from Buffalo, New York. Thursday, October 16th, 1986. The 33rd degree, right from the article I'm quoting, is to be conferred at the next annual session of the Supreme Council in September 1987 in Boston. You see, now you're going to have two 33rd degree Freemasons if the Republicans get elected. Right now you got a Freemason in there, a communist, full-blown Marxist. How long is it going to take for the American people to wake up? Huh? Oh, I can't believe it. I sat there watching these stupid, ignorant sheeple fools as they rose to their feet and applauded and yelled and screamed with tears running down their face. As Pat Buchanan said, "And I hope that the cornerstone that the builders rejected will become..." Let me backtrack. He said, "I hope that the stone that the builders rejected will become the cornerstone of the Republican Party. I hope the stone that the builders rejected will become the cornerstone of the Republican Party." Oh, brother. What am I going to do with you, ladies and gentlemen? And there are many of you out there who still think the term New World Order was penned by George Bush and that it is something new. Well, let me read to you something that was written March the 9th, 1943. In fact, it was acted on March the 9th, 1943 by the Pennsylvania State Senate in their Senate Concurrent Resolution. Serial number 113, Legislative Journal, page 711, by Messrs. Farrell, Carr, and Woodring, providing for a declaration of the Federation of the World in the Senate, March 9th, 1943, State of Pennsylvania. And I'm just going to read you the high points. Whereas it is necessary at the present juncture of human affairs to enlarge the basis of organized society by establishing a government for the community of nations in order to preserve civilization and enable mankind to live in peace and be free, the following principles and objectives are hereby enunciated in the Declaration of the Federation of the World. Communities may exist for a time without being incorporated, but under the stress of adversity, they disintegrate unless legally organized. Talks about integrating the regions. Talks about becoming a bulwark. Talks about the cornerstone, the foundation of democracy, the enlightened sense of obligation. These are all Masonic buzzwords, ladies and gentlemen. Those spiritually cosmic forces which visit the world at critical periods in human history to shape the destinies of men. If democracy wins, the nations of the earth will be united in a commonwealth of free peoples, and individuals, wherever found, will be the sovereign units of the new world order. March 9th, 1943. And those of you in Pennsylvania wonder why your state is doing the things that it's doing? They passed this resolution in 1943. And I'll bet you that they passed it in almost every state of the Union around the same time, or at least in many of the states, in particular on the eastern seaboard, where socialism rules. Democracy, ladies and gentlemen, is a code word for socialism. This is not a democracy, never was, never was supposed to be, never can be, if it remains, and if you remain free. Lenin, that's right, Lenin, V.I. Lenin, the man who started the Bolshevik Revolution and founded the Soviet Union, V.I. Lenin said that democracy is indispensable to socialism. You see, this nation was founded as a republic, and most of you don't even know what that word means, unfortunately. Now I'm going to read to you House Concurrent Resolution 206. Or let me read to you, before I read House Resolution 206, let me read to you the speech on the floor of the House by Mrs. Jackson, or Ms. Jackson Lee of Texas. And this was done August the 2nd, 1996, in the House of Representatives. It's from the Congressional Record. Ms. Jackson Lee of Texas. Mr. Speaker, it has been a week, but certainly we can say that though we may have disagreed, this Congress has attempted to work on behalf of the American people. I would hope that even if something is threatening, that something is confusing, that there is something that we are not sure of, that we still, as a Congress, have the courage to bring it to the attention of the American people. Today I presented to the American people House Concurrent Resolution 206, which is a sense of Congress that expresses the threat to the security of the American citizens and the U.S. government by armed militia. This may not be a popular stance, but it does us no good to hide from the issue. Mr. Speaker, one of the most energetic promoters of the growing anti-government movement in 1995 was Militia of Montana spokesperson Bob Fletcher, shortly after a 2-ton bomb destroyed the near a federal building in Oklahoma, killing 169 people. Fletcher made an announcement to the press, "Expect more bombs." To date, as a freshman, we have not been able to secure from this House an opportunity to have hearings on the militia. The U.S. government is comprised of democratic institutions, and any change to the government should occur by peaceful means. Americans agree with that. They believe in the First Amendment, the right to freedom of expression, and the right to free association. They do not believe in Oklahoma City, Pan Am 103, or TWA 800. And yes, they do not believe in the confrontation of legitimate law enforcement officers by those who would argue that they have the right to overthrow this government. Several members of the Arizona militia have recently been arrested. Our militias have repeatedly denounced the legitimacy of the U.S. government. Our militia consists of more than 800 groups that are active in more than 40 states. This resolution says that Congress resolves to prosecute and identify all armed conspirators that are brought together to overthrow the government of the United States. It resolves that individuals and groups possessing illegal possession of firearms and explosives should be prosecuted to the fullest extent of the law by the Department of Justice. And yes, it resolves that individuals legally possessing firearms and explosives and conspiring to destroy the U.S. government should be prosecuted to the fullest extent of the law. It is important to note that we are not making an issue out of something that should not be made an issue of. The militia in America are convinced that American people are being systematically oppressed by an illegal totalitarian government that is intent of disarming all citizens and creating one world government. They believe that the time for traditional political reform over their freedom will be secured by resistance to the nation's laws and attacks against its institutions. They are not for peaceful addressing of their grievances. The Patriot Press is filled with wild tales of government conspiracies. Some of the most widespread myths assert that the government is using black helicopters to spy on its citizens, mustering Hong Kong police officers to disarm Americans, and implanting electronic monitoring devices in newborn babies. Strange, you say. I think it is important for this Congress to unveil, to disclose all that is being done on behalf of those who would conspire against the U.S. government. No, I am not here to cry fire in a crowded theater, simply asking that we not hide away from the truth. A complex and bizarre theology also helps the patriots explain their belief and justify their tactics. Patriots as a synonymous name for militia. Many subscribe to the identity religion which holds that white people are God's chosen and that it is their divine duty to battle the satanic beast of government. Though they have no unified leader, these patriots are connected like no rebel force has ever been. On the internet and by fax machine, they share their gripes against government and trade tips on how to avoid tax laws and fight government regulation. Through mail-ordered manuals, they learn how to build bombs and conduct surveillance and disable public utilities. On the weekend, in isolated fields, they practice the art of guerrilla warfare. At public meetings, their rage is rationalized by the propaganda of the movement. I would simply say that I ask my colleagues to join me in supporting House Concurrent Resolution 206. Let us unveil for the American people those who would conspire to overthrow this government and seriously address this issue as Americans believing in peace and believing in democracy. Wow. When we come back after this short break, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to tear
this little two-bit lying communist puke-faced scum, no, not scum, sludge to pieces.
The Hour of the Time, as usual, is brought to you by Swiss America Trading, the people in Phoenix who specialize in real money, hard assets, non-confiscatable, non-reportable, that you need to protect everything that you have that you've worked for, because everything's going to come tumbling down. Our government is being controlled now by the biggest pack of communist, Marxist liars that have probably have ever lived upon the face of this earth, and they only have one goal. That's to destroy this nation, disarm its people, destroy, completely obliterate the middle class, and bring about a one-world totalitarian socialist government. One of the ways to do that is to collapse the economy. You see, they must eliminate the middle class. Socialism cannot exist in a society that has classes. A middle class is an anathema to a socialist society. You're going to find that as the years go by, it gets harder and harder to make a decent living. Oh, yes, and your standard of living is going to go down lower and lower and lower until eventually it reaches the same level in every country around the globe, except for those very rich individuals who are controlling and pulling the strings for all of this baloney. And if you don't have something to protect yourself, you're going to find yourself in a ditch. With no job, no money, no roof over your head, sick. Trying to explain to your family, your wife, and your children what happened. So if you don't want to have to be able to do that, and I assure you that once that happens, there is not going to be any explanation that is going to calm their fears or cure their illness. Put a roof over their head or feed them. Nope, you're going to be up the creek without anything. So call Swiss America Trading now and get your hands on some real money before all this occurs, and it is going to occur, I can assure you. 1-800-289-2646. That's 1-800-289-2646. Do it now. You know how you are. You're just like me and everybody else. You tend to procrastinate. Do it now. One morning you're going to wake up and it's going to be too late. And kicking yourself won't hurt at that point. It won't help either. 1-800-289-2646. Ask for Frank. If he's not there, ask for anybody. Thank them for sponsoring the Hour of the Time. You'll get red carpet treatment, I guarantee it.
Oh, beautiful.
Well, let's talk about this puke-faced, communist-lying Ms. Jackson Lee of Texas. Democrat, of course. Socialist. Marxist. Liar par excellence. She wouldn't know anything about America if you sat down with her in a library, even the Library of Congress, and made her study for 6 months. Even if you gave her the books to read, because Ms. Jackson Lee of Texas doesn't have a brain in her head. She's not an American. Not at all. She's a subversive. She says that there is a threat to the security of the American citizens and the U.S. government by armed militia. She is a liar. It is the armed militia that created this country. It is the armed militia that fought most of the battles that were ever fought in the early days of this country. It was the armed militia who took up their weapons and reported for duty and fought the Civil War to free the slaves. It is the armed militia, ladies and gentlemen, that has always preserved this nation. It has been the armed militia, ladies and gentlemen, that has always been willing and ready to answer the call whenever the call has been sounded throughout the history of this country. If there were no threat to the American people, ladies and gentlemen, there would be no armed militia today. If there were no threat to the United States government, there would be no armed militia today. If there were no threat to freedom, there would be no armed militia today. The armed militia in America only springs forth in times of threat to the United States government, to the Constitution for the United States, to the rights of the American people, and to the American people themselves. That is the truth of the matter, Ms. Jackson Lee, liar, puke-faced, Marxist, socialist, subversive. You see, it is Ms. Jackson Lee and those like her in government who are destroying this country, who are destroying government, who are the propaganda experts, who are the liars. She says in 1995, the militia of Montana spokesman Bob Fletcher, shortly after a 2-ton bomb destroyed the Mira Federal Building in Oklahoma, killed 169 people, said, expect more bombs. So did I. So did everybody else in this country who has studied Marxism and socialism and how they ride to power over the bones of those killed by terrorism. So yes, you can expect more bombs, you can expect more terrorism, you can expect more of all of it. You can expect more children to be killed, more women to be killed, more buildings to be blown up, and more planes to crash because these puke-faced, lying Marxist socialists, and I'd better not say what I would like to say, will bring those things into being in order to cause the stupid sheeple in this country to get down on their knees and beg for their rights to be taken away so that they can have more security. Don't believe it? Study Marxism. Study socialism. Study communism. And remember, all of these movements started back in the late 1700s. In the late 1700s, ladies and gentlemen, they just didn't start in this century. They're vicious. They believe that the end justifies the means. They will do anything. They will kill any number of people. They will destroy and injure and torture any number of little children to get their way, to get their control, to exercise their torture. And she says it was a 2-ton bomb. Oh, my goodness. She says, to date, as a freshman, we have not been able to secure from this house an opportunity to have hearings on the militia. Well, that's funny. The militia is willing. The militia has crossed this country has called for hearings on the militia. What's the matter with these puke-faced liars? You know why they won't have hearings on the militia? Because the militia is legal. The militia is lawful. The militia has a duty, an obligation, and a responsibility. The Constitution recognizes the militia as pre-existing the Constitution. The second article in amendment grants the right to the people to keep and bear arms. You see, that is the active clause of that article in amendment. She says the government is comprised of democratic institutions, and any change to the government should occur by peaceful means. Well, this is a republic. It is not a democracy. And if it is comprised of democratic institutions, that means socialism has already grabbed a throat hold on the American people. And change to the government is not occurring by peaceful means, ladies and gentlemen. Look around and seeing how many people are being forced to commit suicide, are being destroyed, are being ruined, are being thrown in jail for nothing. Did you know, are you aware of, that right now the United States has the largest prison population per capita of any nation in the world, and they're building more prisons, and they're funding more prisons, and they're building concentration camps and abandoned military bases across this country? She says Americans believe in the First Amendment. That's right. She says they believe in the right to freedom of expression. That's right. And the right to free association. That's right. Ooh. But if you're exercising those rights and you happen to own a weapon, somehow that's wrong? No. Ms. Jackson Lee of Texas, Marxist, socialist, subversive, is wrong. And then she pulls a real cheap propaganda lie, real cheap trick. It is a lie, and everybody out there listening better start writing letters and call them on this lie. She says they do not believe in Oklahoma City, Pan Am 103, or TWA 800. See, I'm really upset about this. When I get upset, my tongue doesn't always go in the right direction, folks. So you'll have to forgive me. I am a passionate man. She says, they do not believe in Oklahoma City, Pan Am 103, or TWA 800. And yes, they do not believe in the confrontation of legitimate law enforcement officers by those who would argue that they have the right to overthrow this government. You see, she is claiming that the militia is responsible for Oklahoma City, and that is a lie. The Federal Bureau of Investigation announced early on that the militia had nothing to do with the bombing of the Mira Federal Building at all. That Timothy McVeigh, even though he has not been convicted of any crime, was not associated with any militia, and neither was Terry Nichols. The militia had absolutely nothing to do with Pan Am 103, ladies and gentlemen. Nothing whatsoever. It's already been determined that that was an act of Middle East terrorism. But yet, Ms. Puke-faced liar, Ms. Jackson Lee, socialist, Marxist, subversive, is trying to make you think that the militia blew up Pan Am 103, that the militia blew up the Alfred K. Mura Federal Building in Oklahoma City. And she's a liar. And then she says, TWA 800. Nobody knows what happened to TWA 800. Nobody. Nobody has any evidence that anything happened to it as of this date, as of this time, much less the militia. We do know one thing. It was shot down by a missile launched from sea. I don't know any militia navies, do you? And then she says they do not believe in the confrontation of legitimate law enforcement officers by those who would argue that they have the right to overthrow this government. The militia is not engaged in any attempt to overthrow the United States government.
If the militia must act, it will be to restore the United States government as a constitutional republic and reseat the Constitution for the United States of America in its lawful place as the supreme law of the land. That is the duty, the responsibility of the militia and of every man and woman who have ever taken the oath of enlistment or the oath of a commission in the armed services of any branch of the armed forces of the United States of America. My oath said that I will protect and defend the Constitution for the United States of America against all enemies, foreign and, listen carefully, folks, domestic. It is the duty of the militia. If these puke-faced, lying, Marxist, communist subversives continue to destroy this country, to march against them with weapons, to arrest them, to restore the constitutional republic, to convene constitutional trials where they will be tried by a jury of their peers for treason, and if they are found guilty, hung by the neck until they are dead. The first document in law of this nation is the Declaration of Independence. Read it, ladies and gentlemen. It tells us that if our government ever turns oppressive and subversive, and if it ever becomes a tyrant to the people of this country, that we are to march against those people who perform those acts and instate the government that we wish to have. And we wish the constitutional republic that was guaranteed to us and that was put into place by the founding fathers of this country. Anyone who does not like this country or its government or its constitution simply can get on a plane or a boat and get the flock out of Dodge. You hear me, Ms. Jackson Lee? You Marxist subversive? The purpose of the militia is to suppress insurrection, repel invasion, and execute the laws of the Union. Which means if you're out of the bounds of the Constitution for the United States of America, we are to put you back in those bounds and chain you so that you cannot get back out of those bounds. If you are performing unlawful acts, we are to enforce the laws of the Union. If you are performing an insurrection against this government to destroy and bring about a world totalitarian socialist government, it is the purpose of the militia to suppress your insurrection. And if you're from a foreign nation and you are thinking about invading the shores of the United States of America, it is the purpose of the militia to repel that invasion. The militia of every state is subject to the call of the governor, provided that the governor is performing within his constitutional capacity and within the limits of the constitution of his state. If the governor of any state should subvert the constitution of that state and perform illegal and unconstitutional acts against the people of the state, the militia cannot answer the call of the governor, but must march against that governor to restore the constitution of that state as the supreme law of that state. That is the tradition and the history of this country. And Ms. Jackson Lee, if you want to start a war real quick, House of Representatives, Senate, if you want to start a war real quick, you just keep messing with the right of the American people to protect themselves against the tyranny of the Marxist subversives who would take this country down and destroy it. You better be listening really well. Your resolution
is nothing but a piece of garbage bullshit. And it ain't gonna wash out here in the heartland of America. Not at all. She wants to prosecute and identify all armed conspirators that are brought together to overthrow the government of the United States. Well, the militia would like to prosecute and identify all armed conspirators that are brought together to overthrow the government of the United States also. That is the purpose of the militia. Right now, I would say that there are plenty of armed conspirators in the leadership roles and ranks of the armed forces of the United States of America. Conspirators that are brought together to overthrow the government of the United States. And I think that can pretty well be proven. Not only in the higher ranks of the military, but all throughout the bureaucracy of the United States government. They are working in concert with Marxists and socialists around the world to disarm the American people, destroy this country, eliminate the middle class, create a parliamentary regional state under a one-world totalitarian socialist government headed at the United Nations. This is not conjecture. This is not my opinion. I have proven it over and over again on this broadcast by documenting it in the law, in the treaties, in the congressional record, in the Federal Register, in the speeches of these Marxist subversive puke-faced liars. The first issue of Veritas ran 6 entire pages of nothing but quotes from these lying scum, these traitors. We still have some back issues of issue number 1, some copies. You can have it for $5. $5 a piece. Any back issue we have, you can have for $5 a piece. The Patriot Press is filled with wild tales of government conspiracies. Not Veritas, ladies and gentlemen. Nothing is printed in Veritas, and it is thoroughly documented and proven. Thoroughly. Nothing is aired on this broadcast, and it is thoroughly documented and sourced and proven. And you all know that. How does this lying little scum-faced puke Marxist get off calling us conspirators and then say that our press is filled with wild tales of conspiracies? Now, who's the conspiracy nut, her or us? We document and prove what we say. She just makes wild generalizations, spouts a whole bunch of lies, and introduces this as a resolution into Congress. Is Congress full of stupid idiots who have nothing but air between their ears? Is that what you sent to represent you in the House of Representatives, that they hear her get up and make this lie speech and nobody says anything? And it's now in the Judicial Committee, and this is going to come up for a vote. Who's going to vote for it? Who's going to vote against it? You better find out now. And you better find out quick. Yes. Patriots. Look up the definition of the word. Patriots get together and they learn. They learn what's going on. And they pass around documentation. They want to know the truth. They want to stay free. They don't like what's happening to this country. And yes, they are preparing. Not for a conflict that they are going to initiate, but for the final conflict that we know the socialists are going to bring to our doorstep. We will not submit, not ever. We will not disarm. We will not give up our weapons until every bullet is gone. Then you can have them, and we'll take yours. And we'll use yours until every bullet is gone. You have no idea what you are messing with. But you're going to find out if you continue to take away the freedoms and the rights of the American people. The only people in the history of the world who have ever truly been free. And if you think we're going to give that up, the ultimate success of human evolution, you have another think coming, Ms. Jackson Lee. And Ms. Jackson Lee, you better think about it real hard. And all of you other socialist, Marxist, puke-faced, lying propaganda artists, you subversives. It is not the militia that Americans have to fear. It is you. Good night, ladies and gentlemen. God save this republic, and God bless you all.
Tomorrow all the things were gone, worked for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky star to be living here today, but the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away. Proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that fight to me. And I have to stand up next to you and remember till today. But there ain't no doubt I love this man. God bless the USA. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, where there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say. An American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that fight to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her till today. But there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA.
Hello.
Hello, Bill.
Yeah. Hello.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, this is George from Texas. I had left a message on your machine.
Hold on, George.
Okay.
Hello. Yeah. Fax it to me. Fax it to me. Let me give you the number. You've got a fax machine right down at your local copy store. All you got to do is go down and use it. You don't understand something. I have this terrible habit of jotting things down and losing them. Whatever sent in the mail or fax does not get lost. Okay? Great.
Well, of course. Yeah, fax me all that, would you please? Thank you. Sorry, go ahead.
That's all right. Bill, I've been listening to you for a couple, 3 years now, and every night for the last, well, since last November, when I retired from a place in Houston and moved up here, by the way, that's where Ms. Sheila Jackson Lee was a councilman, or a council Marxist on the city council there. And I want to tell you that tonight, I believe this show is one of the best that I've ever heard you put on the air. It was just awe-inspiring. That's not exactly why I called, but I just wanted to pass that along to you. I need the address for Harvest, or I need a catalog for Harvest so I can order some tapes, in particular the public notice tapes that you did.
Well, you might also want to order issue number 14 of Veritas. You can get it right now for $3.
Okay. I was going to ask you, that all is in print.
You're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Ladies and gentlemen, the other night I read from a speech to the House by Ms. Jackson Lee of Texas, a Marxist subversive who is doing everything she can to help destroy this country. And I did not address one of the points that she had in here that I must address, because it really makes me very angry, this piece of scum, this sludge who calls herself a congresswoman, this empty, airheaded slanderer. I don't believe that this woman, or any of the other people who have signed on to this four-page piece of crap, have any brains. I don't believe that they know anything about the history of this country or about what America is all about. They know what their Marxist dream for the future is, and that's what they're working for. And that's the only thing that they care about. Remember, they believe that the end justifies the means. Let me see if I can find it here. Oh, here we go. She talks in here about militia members and patriots being racist and belonging to the identity religion, which holds that white people are God's chosen, and that it is their divine duty to battle the satanic beast of government. You know, Ms. Jackson Lee, you better get your nose out of Mr. Morris D's butt, because that's exactly where you have it firmly planted. Morris D's is a liar. I don't know one single militia member, not one, ladies and gentlemen, at all, who is a racist. I don't know one single person personally. I know of people, but I don't know one single person personally as a patriot or militia member anywhere in this country who belongs to the identity religion. And I've got to tell you, Ms. Jackson Lee, that if somebody did belong to the identity religion and they formed a militia based upon the beliefs of that religion and restricted their membership to the people who believed in that particular dogma, it is not a militia. The militia must be formed under the law. The law says that every able-bodied man, and I believe that you can include women if they wish to volunteer in this day and age, but the law specifically states every able-bodied man or boy between the ages of, and it depends upon the state as to what those ages are, with the United States, it is embodied in Title 10 of the United States Code. And that means that the militia is impossible to be racist. Because everybody in this country between those ages, according to the law, are members of the militia. And anyone who has served honorably in any of the branches of the armed services is a member of the militia until age 65, or the age where they cannot any longer, due to health or physical restraints, serve. And that's also embodied in the law. Every state in the Union and the United States provides for an unorganized militia, which in the law is distinctly separate from the National Guard or from the State Guard or from any other guard or any other military body. I hope you people are calling your Congress people, your representatives, and I hope you're writing them and setting them straight on this, because we cannot allow this to go unchallenged. Cannot. At all. It is beyond the pale, so to speak. And I have here a fax from the Citizens for a Constitutional Washington, whatever that means. I think it should be a constitutional America. Oh, you're very beautiful. You've got on all your new clothes and your new shoes. Okay. Now, you need to go get ready for bed, because it's late. But you are very beautiful. Thank you for dressing up and coming to show me.
You're welcome.
I appreciate that. I'll see you later.
Bye.
Bye. Well, I'm not going to apologize for that interruption, folks, because I thoroughly enjoy it. Anyway, I think it should be a constitutional country, a constitutional America, a constitutional republic, which we are guaranteed under the Constitution. We're guaranteed a republican form of government under the Constitution for the United States of America and the constitutions of our individual several states. But anyway, they sent me this fax, and it's pretty good, so I want to read it to you. It said, HCR 206 sets a very dangerous precedent, and technically is a subversive piece of legislation. You see, they think just like I do. Anyone who understands the Constitution and wants the rule of the Constitution to prevail knows that that legislation is subversive. It is Marxist. It is treasonous. The document suggests that Ms. Lee is not in touch with the history of this nation. Sounds like me talking, doesn't it? Nor does she understand the intent of the framers of the Constitution to provide the citizenry their one final safeguard against a tyrannical and despotic government when they inserted the Second Amendment into the Bill of Rights. However, notwithstanding the Second Amendment, the preamble to the Bill of Rights says it all. And most Americans do not even know that the Bill of Rights has a preamble, ladies and gentlemen. We covered it almost 4 years ago, and then 3 years ago, and probably 2 years ago on this broadcast. And we're going to do it again tonight. And most copies of the Bill of Rights do not include the preamble. And you should not have a Bill of Rights unless it does include the preamble, because it sets the legal reason for the Bill of Rights to exist. Listen to this. The conventions of a number of the states, having at the time of their adopting the Constitution, expressed a desire in order to prevent misconstruction or abuse of its powers that further declaratory and restrictive clauses should be added, and as extending the ground of public confidence in the government will best ensure the beneficent ends of its institution. End quote. Likewise, ladies and gentlemen, the preamble to the Constitution itself describes the intent and the supreme public policy of the document, to wit, quote, "We the people, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America," end quote. It is not the Constitution of the United States of America, ladies and gentlemen. It is not the U.S. Constitution. It is not the United States Constitution. The proper name is the Constitution for the United States of America. This preamble was passed without debate August 7th, 1787. Now, notice that the Bill of Rights came later, ladies and gentlemen. You see, they tried to pass the Constitution or adopt the Constitution, and the members of the states would not accept it without the Bill of Rights. And the preamble to the Bill of Rights sets the stage for its reason and its effect, and clearly provides the statement that the Bill of Rights was added to the Constitution to make sure there would be no misconstruction or abuse of powers by the government, that further declaratory and restrictive clauses should be added, and as extending the ground of public confidence in the government will best ensure the beneficent ends of its institution. The intent of the framers is revealed by Hamilton in Federalist Papers number 84, to wit, quote, "It has been several times truly remarked that bills of rights are in their origin stipulations between kings and their subjects, abridgments of prerogative in favor of their privilege, reservations of rights not surrendered to the price. Such was Magna Carta, obtained by the barons sword in hand from King John. Such were the subsequent confirmations of that charter by subsequent princes. Such was the petition of rights assented to by Charles I in the beginning of his reign. Such also was the declaration of right presented by the Lords of Commons to the Prince of Orange in 1688, and afterwards thrown into the form of an act of Parliament called the Bill of Rights. It is evident, therefore, that according to their primitive signification, they have no application to constitutions professionally founded upon the power of the people and executed by their immediate representatives and servants. Here, in strictness, the people surrender nothing, and as they retain everything, they have no need of particular reservations. We, the people of the United States, to secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America. Here is the better recognition of popular rights than volumes of transferisms, which make the principal figure in several of our state Bill of Rights, and which would sound much better in a treatise of ethics than in a constitution of government, end quote. We wonder what it is that Ms. Jackson Lee does not understand about her oath of office, especially since she is a former staff attorney for the American Bar Association, a practicing attorney for 12 years, a member of the Texas Bar Association, and a former Houston, Texas municipal judge. Her background lends itself to an ability to comprehend the legal terms of the contract, the Constitution for the United States of America. We must also ask of Ms. Lee what it is she does not understand about the last four words in the Second Amendment. Quote, shall not be infringed, end quote. From the book Debates in the Several States Conventions on the Adoption of the Federal Constitution, the Jonathan Elliott edition, Volume 3, we find the following quotes, which are more than apropos, considering the evil intent of Ms. Jackson Lee and the co-sponsors of HCR 206. Henry, at Volume 3, page 45. Suspicion is a virtue as long as its object is the preservation of the public good and as long as it stays within proper bounds. Guard with jealous attention the public liberty. Suspect everyone who approaches that jewel. Unfortunately, nothing will preserve it but downright force. Whenever you give up that force, you are inevitably ruined. End quote. Henry, Volume 3, page 59. Show me that age and country where no rights and liberties of the people were placed on the sole chance of their rulers being good men, without consequent loss of liberty. I say that the loss of that dearest privilege has ever followed with absolute certainty every such mad attempt. End quote. And Iredell, at Volume 4, page 130. The only real security of liberty in any country is the jealousy and circumspection of the people themselves. Let them be watchful over their rulers. Should they find a combination against them, they have, thank God, an ultimate remedy. That power which created the government can destroy it. Should the government, on trial, be found to want amendments, those amendments can be made in a regular method, in a mode prescribed by the Constitution itself. We have this security, in addition to the natural watchfulness of the people, which I hope will never be found wanting. End quote. Now, in regards to that last quote, ladies and gentlemen, what he's talking about is making laws. Making laws, ladies and gentlemen, that are blatantly unconstitutional. Performing actions and functions and taking jurisdictions and powers that clearly are forbidden by the Constitution. He is saying that we have a mode to make amendments should they be so desired. And that is the only way that these things can be done. Nowadays, they just ignore it and do it anyway. Our founding fathers knew that this could happen, and that's why they gave us an ultimate method of defense, the second article in amendment. Reviewing the short biography of Ms. Jackson Lee as contained in the 104th Congressional Directory, and knowing how the anti-American law monopoly, the American Bar Association, came into being at the University of Chicago upon a $40 million contribution by philanthropist Mr. John D. Rockefeller, and reviewing the high-flown rhetoric of Ms. Jackson Lee's HCR 206, we are persuaded of several things. One, that she does not understand American law or the Constitution for the United States of America. Or two, the document is obviously of communist origin. And three, that Ms. Jackson is a subversive socialist pinko communist who is participating in the overthrow of our constitutional and republican form of government. We note that Ms. Jackson Lee graduated with a Bachelor of Arts from Yale University. Are females allowed membership in Yale's Skull and Bones, like George Herbert Walker Bush, another socialist New World Order monger? Or did she come about this from some other means? We would appreciate it very much if you would inform your readership of the foregoing information in the attached House Concurrent Resolution 206. And, of course, we were in the process of doing that when I received this fax, probably because of last night's broadcast. And tonight, I had planned to read you House Resolution H-Con Res 206. And I'm going to do that real quick, right now, so listen carefully. 104th Congress, Second Session, H-Con Res 206. Expressing the sense of Congress with respect to the threat to the security of American citizens and the United States government posed by armed militia and other paramilitary groups and organizations in the House of Representatives, August 1, 1996. Ms. Jackson Lee of Texas for herself, Mr. Conyers, Ms. Norton, Mr. Frazier, Mr. Flake, appropriate name, that Mr. Flake, Mrs. Lowy, Mr. Rangel, Mr. Hastings of Florida, Ms. Millinder McDonald, Ms. DeLauro, Mr. Clyburn, Mr. Hilliard, Mr. Wynn, Mr. Luer of Georgia, Mr. Payne of New Jersey, Mrs. Clayton, Mr. Owens, Mr. Fields of Louisiana, Mr. Cummings, Ms. Collins of Michigan, Mr. Schumer, of course, Mr. Schumer, the biggest scum-sucking pig in Congress. You talk about a traitor. That's probably the most hated man in America. Who elected this guy? Mr. Scott, Mr. Pastor, Mrs. Meek of Florida, Ms. Brown of Florida, Ms. McKinney, Mr. Foglietta, Mr. Richardson, Mr. Coleman, Ms. Eddie, Bernice Johnson of Texas, Mr. Jackson of Illinois, Mrs. Collins of Illinois, Mr. Engel, Mrs. Schroeder, of course, Mrs. Schroeder, another traitor, Mrs. Maloney, they're all traitors, to tell you the truth, Ms. Velasquez, Mr. Gutierrez, Mr. Cardin, Mr. Serrano, Mr. Becerra, or Becerra, Mr. Gibbons, Mr. Nadler, Mr. Kennedy of Rhode Island, Mr. Clay, and Ms. Lovgren submitted the following concurrent resolution, which was referred to the Committee on the Judiciary. Concurrent resolution. Listen carefully, folks. Expressing the sense of Congress with respect to the threat to the security of American citizens and the United States government posed by armed militia and other paramilitary groups and organizations. Whereas the government of the United States and its agencies are democratic institutions created by and for the people of the United States. Whereas the various agencies of the United States government derive their purpose and their character from the expressed will of the American people and may be altered from time to time by peaceful means. Whereas 168 American men, women, and children were killed in the terrorist bombing of the Alfred P. Mura Federal Building in April 1995. Whereas federal law enforcement officials were threatened and held at bay for 81 days in a Montana town by a group of so-called freemen while trying to exercise their duty to uphold the law at a cost of millions of dollars to American taxpayers. Whereas various spokespersons for self-described militia and paramilitary organizations and groups have repeatedly denounced the legitimacy of the United States government. Whereas several members of an Arizona militia group were recently arrested in possession of heavy armaments, deadly bombs, and explosive devices, and charged with conspiring to use explosives to destroy buildings housing federal agencies. Whereas experts have estimated that extremist anti-government militia groups and organizations in the United States may number as many as 800, existing in more than 40 states. Well, that's comforting, folks. That means they don't know about all of us. Whereas the democratic institutions of the United States and the American people are protected from both foreign and domestic enemies by a well-trained military and multiple layers of legitimate state and local police organizations, and whereas the actions of some militia and paramilitary groups and organizations specifically promoting violence constitute a grave danger to American citizens and the institutions of American democracy, and threaten the very foundation of freedom and democracy in America, now therefore be it, one, resolved by the House of Representatives, the Senate concurring, that it is the sense of Congress that, one, armed conspiracies against the government of the United States or any of its agencies and personnel should be aggressively identified, dissolved, and their perpetrators brought to justice by the federal authorities of law enforcement with the greatest dispatch possible. Two, the illegal possession of firearms, explosives, or any substances or devices of destruction by any individual or group should be prosecuted to the full extent of all applicable laws by the Department of Justice, and three, those legally possessing firearms, explosives, or any substance or device of destruction and involved in any conspiracy to harm or destroy any agency or property of the United States government or any official of the United States government or any person should be promptly prosecuted to the full extent of all applicable laws by the Department of Justice, including those designed to protect the United States government against treason and subversion. That's the end of it, ladies and gentlemen. You see what they have done? They have put together a whole bunch of lies. And let's go through some of those lies. First, they say there's a threat to the security of American citizens and the United States government posed by armed militia and other paramilitary groups and organizations. And that is a lie. There is no threat to the United States government, the legitimate United States government, under the Constitution for the United States of America. There is a definite threat to any other subversive government which may be trying to destroy that government from within or from without. And there is definitely a threat from the militia to any of the conspirators and traitors who are involved in that subversion of the legitimate constitutional government of the United States of America and or any of the several states. They say, whereas the government of the United States and its agencies are democratic institutions, that is a lie. The United States government is a Republican constitutional government. A Republican form of government is guaranteed to us within that document. Lenin said, democracy is indispensable to socialism, and in fact is the first rung upon the ladder to destruction. Whereas 168 American men, women, and children were killed in the terrorist bombing of the Alfred P. Murrah Federal Building in April 1995. Number one, they don't know if it was a terrorist bombing. In fact, it can't be a terrorist bombing because terrorist bombings always have a goal in bombing. In other words, when terrorists bomb, they do it for a reason. They do it to gain a political advantage. They do it to have prisoners released. They do it to make armies leave occupied areas. There was no such thing happened with the bombing of the Alfred P. Murrah Federal Building. No one has been proven to be guilty of that bombing. And I'm going to tell you right now, the federal government does not have a case against either Terry Nichols or Timothy McVeigh. When you read Oklahoma City Day One, you will begin to understand why they don't have a case against these two men. No militia and no militia member has been implicated, arrested, or charged or convicted in connection with the Alfred P. Murrah Federal Building bombing on April the 19th, 1995. The FBI has specifically stated that no militia was involved. There is no militia conspiracy. This is on record. They did it at a press conference, ladies and gentlemen. No militia was involved. Timothy McVeigh and Terry Nichols were not members of any militia, and that there is no militia conspiracy. Then they say that federal law enforcement officials were threatened and held at bay for 81 days in a Montana town by a group of so-called freemen. The freemen, ladies and gentlemen, were not a militia. Were not a militia. While they could have probably formed themselves as a militia in defense of their so-called justice township, they did not. The name freeman has nothing to do with militia, ladies and gentlemen. They had never stated that they were militia. Neither did the FBI ever state that they were militia. Then they say, whereas various spokespersons for self-described militia and paramilitary organizations and groups have repeatedly denounced the legitimacy of the United States government, that is a lie. We have denounced the illegal activities of some persons acting under the color of law outside of the limits of the Constitution who are members of the federal government or who are agencies of the federal government. The militias support the legitimate United States government, which is the supreme law of the land, the Constitution for the United States of America, and all of its amendments, which were legally and properly brought about and ratified. And one we know was not, and that's the 16th Amendment. Then they say several members of an Arizona militia group were recently arrested in possession of heavy armaments, deadly bombs, and explosive devices, and charged with conspiring to use explosives to destroy buildings housing federal agencies. That entire paragraph is a lie. Number one, as I explained to you before, it was not an Arizona militia group. It was a loose-knit organization of people who did things together, mostly on motorcycles. They were not in possession of any heavy armaments whatsoever. They had no bombs whatsoever. They had no explosive devices, and they were not charged with conspiring to use Believe me, go down and get the court records and you will see. And there are many more, but I think you get my drift. They want to use these lies as excuses to go after legitimate, decent, law-abiding American citizens who are the only ones in this country that have the guts to stand up and protect the freedom of all the sheeple and cowards who don't have any guts at all. They're the same people who created this country. They're the same people who've always marched off to fight this country's wars. They're the same people that when no other person in the neighborhood will act, they do. They are the people who, when a woman is being raped in an alley, will not walk by like the rest of the sheeple cowards on the sidewalk will do, but will instead go to their aid. They are the men and women of character who have moral standards, who believe in right and wrong. They don't have to be of any religion, but most are, because that is usually the wellspring of moral values. They believe in family life. They love their children. They're usually good workers. And they have never failed in the history of this country to give their life whenever it was necessary, when they answered the call to protect the Constitution for the United States of America and fight this country's wars and battles. Whether as an official member of a government military force or as a volunteer militia member, and if you don't think that's true, folks, you go back and study the real history of this country. You'll find that most wars were fought by militia members who volunteered
with the other men in their community, gathered their weapons, provided their own uniforms, their own guns and ammunition, and marched off to fight on behalf of the American people. So, now that we've sort of laid that to rest, not, won't be laid to rest until you all get off your lazy butts and do something about it. And that is the truth. Don't go away. We'll take your calls.
Cause them wasn't the latest man. He just come along from up under his arm like that. Quick as a cat in the jungle. Clark Kent, now there was a real gent. He would not be caught sitting around in no jungle scheme. Dumber than he doing nothing. Superman never made any money, stealing the world from Solomon Grundy. And sometimes I despair the world will never see another man like him.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Hour of the Time is brought to you by Swiss America Trading. Swiss America Trading specializes in non-reportable, non-confiscatable hard assets. Real money, usually in the form of gold or silver coin. Not too many Americans really know what money is. Money is not a Federal Reserve note, which, by the way, isn't a note, and there is no Federal Reserve. It's a privately owned corporation. Most Americans are totally confused about these things. See, one of the most important things in their lives, they know absolutely nothing about. Well, if the Federal Reserve is not federal, it's a private organization. And a Federal Reserve note is not money, and it's not even a note, as it says. What is it? Ladies and gentlemen, according to law, it's counterfeit, worthless scrap paper. You see, money has to have an intrinsic value all its own. Money has to be a commodity. A Federal Reserve note is worth nothing, cannot be exchanged for anything. If you take it to the bank and you put it on the counter and say, give me the money of account which backs this piece of paper, the girl will scratch her head, run off, and find the bank manager who will come and tell you very quickly that there isn't anything. And if you don't like it, there's nothing you can do about it. So, if it's just a piece of paper and it has no value, is there really any difference between a $1 Federal Reserve note and a $100 Federal Reserve note? Ladies and gentlemen, the only difference is the ink, shaped on one into the number one and on another into the number 100. And it's worth exactly what fools are willing to exchange for it, and nothing more. You see, the law specifically says that a dollar is a specific weight and measurement of purity of silver coin. And it can also be an equivalent value of gold coin. Wow. How about that? Do you know what that value is? Do you know what that weight is? Do you know what that purity is? I'd venture to say that you don't. Do you know that the Constitution makes it clear in Article 1, Section 8, that no state shall tender in payment of debt anything other than gold or silver coin? Wow. That sure changes things, doesn't it? And one night after the conference is over, I will air Stephen Jacobson's tape about money that most of you who don't know anything about money will stand in awe of. And I mean that sincerely. You will stand in awe of the information on that tape. We've done it before on the Hour of the Time, and I think maybe it's time to do it again. In the meantime, in light of what you've just heard, maybe you should take some pains to get your hands on some real money, because sooner or later, this phony house of cards is going to come tumbling down around your ears. And if you don't have any real money, when you walk out and try to tender that phony stuff that you've been carrying around and using all these years, guess what? I won't take it, and nobody that I know of is going to take it either. And in the socialist New World Order, they're going to take your land and property because you're not going to be allowed to own property in the New World Order. You'll be able to lease it or rent it from the state, but that's about it. So, if you think that you're protected, if you think that you've done the right thing with your money, you'd better think again. And once you've done that, call Swiss America Trading and thank them for sponsoring the Hour of the Time. Ask them for the latest newsletter. Find out how you can get your hands on some real money. You'll be treated with red carpet treatment. I guarantee you, all you have to do is say, I listen to the Hour of the Time. And I thank you for sponsoring that broadcast. 1-800-289-2646 is the number. 1-800-289-2646. Do it now.
Great job. Even though he could have smashed any bank in the United States, he had the strength, but he would not. Folks dead, his family were all dead. Planet crumbled, but Superman, he forced himself to carry on. Get Krypton and keep going. Superman never made any money. Saved the world from God and Gandhi. And sometimes I despair the world will never see another man like him. Tarzan is king of the jungle and lord over all he hates. But he could hardly have screamed the words, I, Tarzan, you Jane. Sometimes when superstar and cries, I'll bet he was tempted to just quit and turn his back on him. Join Tarzan, you was. But he stayed in the city. Kept on changing clothes and dirty old phone booths till his work was done. And nothing to do but go on home. Superman never made any money. Sometimes I despair the world will never see another man like him. And sometimes I despair the world will never see another man like him.
Good evening. You're on the air.
Hello, Bill. It's Michael in Canada calling.
Yes.
We've got some Canadian music in there. That's the Crash Test Dummies from Toronto.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, good choice, Superman.
I love that song.
It's a nice piece. Me too. It's interesting, this congresswoman, congressperson, how these tricksters point their finger at the innocents while they put their subversive plans into action. If these militias pose such a threat, the constitutional militias in the United States pose such a threat, I'm curious as to where the defense dollars in the United States are going, who can't deal with these small groups. I mean, she doesn't really get the numbers accurate, so it doesn't seem like a lot of people to contend with, but they pose such a threat. And then while she's at it, she can examine all the intelligence budgets as well, because they're not doing their job in stopping these groups or keeping the cocaine out and all the rest of it. It's so easy to see. It's almost pathetic. You know, and I thank you for presenting this to me, a Canadian. It's great to hear this, because we don't have your brand of patriotism and truth here. It's non-existent.
Well, you've already slid into the bottomless pit.
The socialist sellout.
Yep.
You know, and I don't understand it. How can these militias pose such a threat when they are for the betterment of the people? And she knows that. I believe they do know what they're doing. You know.
I don't think they do. You see, you can't do what they're doing if they don't believe in what they're doing and believe that we're all wrong. They believe it. They've been brainwashed. They've been totally screwed with. They don't have any logical way of thinking.
I mean, that's the product of Yale University or Yale education?
Probably started long before that. You know, she's a product of Texas democracy. Lyndon Baines Johnson probably came from one of the areas where socialism bought the vote. Anyway, got to move on to another caller. Thanks, Michael, for calling.
Good night.
Good night. 520-333-4578 is the number. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hello, Mr. Cooper. How are you doing today?
Well, you ought to know by now if you've been listening.
In Van Nuys, Richmond, Texas.
What can I do for you?
Well, I've been listening to you for a while, and I'd just like to know what you would say as far as when things might, or at what point would you think that things might stop being civil and being serious.
April 19th, 1993.
Well, I mean, how would you, I understand that date, but I understand that.
Where were you on that day?
Well, I was working hard.
I was in Waco, Texas, trying to stop it.
I understand. I do understand that, and I was really incensed by what I saw, and it's probably as well as you were, and probably most of the people that, you know, witnessed it. But what do you do when it comes to a point of there is such a small amount of people that are willing to put themselves on the line to...
Anyone who's not willing to die for their principles and ideals, and specifically for freedom, will not long have it.
Well, let me ask you another question. You know, at what point do good men stop being civil and start being taking action as far as, you know, literal action? It's not legal action.
April 19th, 1993.
And that's basically it, huh?
You better believe it.
Let me
tell you something. If everybody had just shouldered a .22 rifle and marched down there and stood between those federal puke-faced, jack-booted thugs and those poor people in that church, nothing would have happened.
Sir, I agree with you on that 100%. There are so very few people in this country, especially where I live around here, that... would, you know, put their principles on the line for anything. How do you explain to people how serious, you know, things have become? And that
you can't. They have to see it for themselves. And if they can't see it for themselves, you're wasting your breath talking to them. Find someone who can see it and talk to them.
And how do you go about finding somebody like that that you agree with? And, I mean, I agree with what you say, and I pretty much I see the things that you see, but other people are so blind to it.
No, that's not true. There are a lot of people who are not blind to it, and there are people in your area that you haven't met that aren't blind to it. If I couldn't find anybody, I'd run a newspaper ad.
Okay.
I just put an ad in the paper. Is there anybody in this county that understands that something's wrong in this country? Please call me. I'd like to get together with you.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's pretty good advice. I have contacted at least one person in the same county that I'm in down here. That, as a matter of fact, because of your program, I heard them the speech that you aired by Carl Haggard. I called him because I've known him for several years.
Carl Haggard is one of the best men in this country, in my estimation.
I have procrastinated, joining up with him just for the lack of procrastination.
Well, you better do something quick because procrastinators always wake up too late.
Like I said, I have procrastinated on a little bit, and I do intend to get with him. Like I say, I've known him for a long time, and I just have gotten in contact with him recently. And I like the man. He's a good man. And he's the sole person in this whole, county that I have talked to that, pretty much feels the same way that I do about things.
Well, I'll guarantee you there's others.
Okay. Well, I sure appreciate it. Have a good day.
Thank you for calling. 520-333-4578. Time to act is now, ladies and gentlemen. Everybody calls me up and says, when do you think it's all going to start? It's already started! Good evening. You're on the air.
Super. How you doing?
Good.
Sam from Maryland.
What can I do for you?
Well, you were talking about the preamble to the Bill of Rights earlier, so out of curiosity, I pulled out my copy of the Maryland Constitution, which includes the United States Constitution in the back of the book, and lo and behold, the preamble's been removed.
Yes.
Surprise, surprise.
See, they don't want you to know that the purpose of the Bill of Rights was to further restrict and limit the government and retain power for the people and for the states, and that the second article and amendment means exactly what it says.
Right.
It means that if you mess with us, if you try to become a tyrant, if you try to oppress or enslave the American people, we will take up arms against you. Not against the legitimate and lawful United States government, but against those oppressors, those tyrants, those subversives, the traitors, who would destroy this country from within or from without. Makes no difference.
Interesting to note in the Maryland Constitution itself that it almost touches on that very same language in the original document.
Yeah.
I wonder what you think of the constitutional rally being held by Citizens Against Legal Loopholes come Labor Day weekend.
I think that is absolutely the most foolish thing that anybody could do is to gather such a large number of patriot leaders and patriots in one spot within total federal jurisdiction.
You don't think that what they're doing is a good thing?
I didn't say what they're doing is not a good thing. I said today, right now, with legislation such as that, with them just itching to get their hands on the leaders and the top patriots in this country, to have such a large gathering of patriot leaders and patriots within the total jurisdiction and control of the federal government, that's what I said.
I heard that. But we got to take a risk sometime to try to get things resolved peacefully, don't we?
Oh, my friend, I think you need to reassess the situation. There's not going to be a peaceful solution to this. We would love for there to be. But do you see them restoring the Constitution? Do you see them staying within their jurisdiction? Do you see them obeying the law? Do you see them stopping acting under the color of law? Do you see them destroying Americans and American families for $10? Do you see people being murdered for nothing? Well, I do. Until they start performing within the limits prescribed by the Constitution for the United States of America, there will be no peaceful solution. I've worked for years for a peaceful solution. I have tried my best to wake up enough people so that there could be a political consensus, so that there had to be a peaceful solution. And then go watch all of the fools and sheeple at the Republican National Convention and tell me about a peaceful solution. Good evening. You're on the air.
Bill, this is Ken from Fort Worth. How you doing?
Good.
Enjoying your show for many, many years. I got a bonus thing with you.
Go.
Every time you say the word Treasury Gate, you never say anything about Tommy Buckley, that he sued the Federal Reserve Corporation over a $278 billion bearer bond in a court of claims, court case 93-5.
Good night. You got a bone to pick with the wrong person. The bone you need to pick is with Tommy Buckley. That whole thing is a scam. It's fake. It's false. He doesn't have any court case. He's not going to win anything. His so-called Treasury Gate documents are fake, counterfeit. And if you don't believe me, you just keep watching it. Good evening. You're on the air.
Yes. How you doing, Mr. Cooper?
I'm doing fine, but if you don't turn off your radio, you're history.
Okay. I subscribed to Veritasat, and I had one question on that.
Uh-huh.
Okay, the symbol of the lady, what did that mean? Do you have a message to that?
Yeah, that's the ancient symbol for the naked truth.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
No, you'll see right underneath it says Nuda Veritas.
Right.
That's naked truth. The ancient symbol for the naked truth is a woman in the nude holding a mirror looking at herself. Nothing is hidden. All is revealed.
Right. Okay, I enjoyed your show. Just keep up the good work then.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you for calling. Yeah, I bet there were a lot of other people out there wondering about that. Good evening. You're on the air.
Yes, Bill. Two questions here. First one is, could you possibly repeat the names of the books on the preparing for the Depression and the fall of Rome at some later date? And
I don't even know what you're talking about.
You had recommended for reading a book on how to prepare for what's coming as regards to the historical records of the Great Depression.
Who did? You got your shows mixed up.
Okay.
You're thinking about somebody else.
Okay. Is there any chance you could repeat the address for forwarding the self-evaluation for assignment within the Second Continental Army?
Yeah. It's just send it to me.
Okay. Thanks a lot, Bill.
Mm-hmm. And that's P.O. Box 1970. Oh, wait a minute. Okay. That's the Sholo address. I'm sorry. That's P.O. Box 1420, Sholo, Arizona, 85901. That's P.O. Box 1420, Sholo, Arizona, 85901. And I think we got enough time for maybe one more call. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hi, Bill. How you doing?
Good.
I wonder if I could ask you some of the...
Why does everybody ask me how I'm doing? It gets old. Every caller asks me how I'm doing. I'm not doing any worse or better than I was when the last caller asked me that.
But it cuts the nervousness here. I'm the first time I ever called you.
I know. I'm just trying to...
I have a little Southeast Asia vacation back in 68 and 69, and I suffer from PTSD, and I just wanted to convey something to you. I am so totally thrilled to have Pooh do the Pledge of Allegiance and see her voice mature. And I'd like to ask you a question that's not too personal. How do you maintain the stress and the anger and the rage when you address your daughter like you did the first part of the program tonight?
How do I restrain it? I didn't have any anger or rage.
Not with her, but I mean, how do you maintain your composure? Because the more I study and the more
I'm human like everybody else. I don't always maintain my composure. I get angry like everybody else, and sometimes I yell and holler. And a couple of times sometimes I might go out and kick the trash can or throw something across the mountain.
Any specific thing that you could help me with, perchance?
Yeah, don't hold it in. You see, that's why I yell and scream sometimes, and that's why I go out and throw something across the mountain, because if you hold it in, it becomes a poison that will devour you and consume you.
Well, I tell you, it's doing a good...
Get rid of it.
Yeah, it's really doing a good job, and I really commend you for her part in the program, because it makes me feel like there's some hope out there. The more I study, the more I get frustrated, and I try to do some things. I try to educate people, but it just doesn't seem to be working.
Well, all I can tell you is, don't give up.
I appreciate it, and thanks for Pooh. I really appreciate it.
Thank you for calling.
Yeah.
Well, that's it, folks. We've got to head on out of here because we're out of time. And don't forget, stay tuned all this week. As soon as I know, I'll tell you the frequency of where we're going and all of the details and times and everything. It will be earlier. Good night, and God bless you all.